Hello everybody, my name is Mathieu Scoutelou and I'm a third year PhD student from the INRIA Rennes in France. During this presentation, we talk about preventing timing information leakage from the processor microarchitecture. This work was done with Ronan Lazerme from the INRIA, Christophe Bidorme from Centrasulpelec, and Jacques Fournier from the CELETI. We will start this presentation with a short review of the root cause of mainly timing leakage, and we will see that we are facing an isolation issue. Then I will present our approach against these threats in two parts. The first one is about the instruction set architecture, or ISA, and its role, and how it can be modified to build security guarantees. And the second part is about the modification of the microarchitecture, and more precisely, the design of shared resources to restore an isolation between the different executions. I will also present our new security benchmark, TimeSecBench, that we have used to measure the leakage in our designs. And finally, we will conclude about the whole presentation. So first, the case of the isolation issue. The role of a processor is to execute the different instructions which compose the software. Each instruction corresponds to one or more operation described by the ISA, and the microarchitecture is finally the hardware part of the system which perform the execution of this operation. This is the components which is responsible of this task. Modern microarchitecture, as illustrated here with the Intel Skylake, are the result of decades of optimization, particularly to improve the system performance. So the ability of the processor to execute a lot of instructions in a short amount of time will impact the performance of the whole system. And finally, this microarchitecture are now really complex systems composed of many mechanisms. At the heart of each processor, there is a key principle called resource sharing. So resource sharing allows to multiple entities to request the same resource. Entities and resources can have different forms. So for entities, it can be hardware thread, cores, or processes. And for resources, it can be complex mechanisms like cache memories or prediction table, but also really simple ones like final state machine or buffer. Execution units or buses or other resources which are also shared between different entities. Finally, we can distinguish two kinds of sharing. We have temporal sharing, where resources can be used at different point in time by different entities, or spatial sharing, where a resource can be used simultaneously by multiple entities. And both kinds of sharing are not exclusive and can be combined. Finally, resource sharing is useful to reduce the cost, to allow the execution of different programs, and also to increase the performance. For example, by allowing some parallelism without duplicating the whole system. The more representative case of sharing in the microarchitecture is cache memories. They are shared at multiple levels between thread, cores, or processes. The issue with cache memories, like for many shared resources, is that they share more than simple data. They also share metadata like timing information. Then, by performing some timing measurement, entities can recover some information of each other, like, for example, data usage. In this case, we have thread 0 and 1 which share the L2 cache. If the first thread uses data, the other one can detect it by accessing the same one and measuring the memory access time. If the access lasts many cycles, it indicates that the data was not in the cache and then not previously used. Else, if it lasts a few cycles, it indicates that the data is present, and the entity can deduce that the other thread has previously used it. And the same kinds of deduction can be done with most of the shared resources in the whole microarchitecture. Finally, a simple conclusion could have been that we are facing an implementation issue, because the targeted resources are only in the microarchitecture, and they are completely independent of the different executed programs. The leakage depends on the implementation and its internal mechanisms. They are not always the same for all processors. And finally, most of the exploited phenomena are invisible for the software. This one has no control over what happens at the hardware level. But we will now see that this point of view is too reductive. It leads to the first part of our approach, the role of the ISA and how to modify it. We know that a complete system has three main parts: the hardware, which performs the different operations; the software, which can be seen as a list of operations to describe an application; and the ISA, which is the interface between them and offer an abstraction of the hardware to the software. For example, the instruction available for the software and which must be implemented by the hardware are defined at this level. To understand all the dimensions of our problem, we have to answer some questions. First, which parts know the application constraints? Here, it is the software which is developed independently of the implementation. The constraints completely depend on the executed application. For example, different applications will not necessarily have the same security needs. Second, which part can efficiently make the isolation? Here, pure software countermeasure against Spectre attacks have shown that without a perfect control on the microarchitecture, software cannot do that due to the complexity of modern implementation. Another strategy can be to modify the ISA to give more tools to the software. But modify the ISA to manage all the possible shared resources is not possible due to their number. For example, we cannot consider each possible FSM one by one. Moreover, shared resources are implementation dependent. This approach is not compatible with abstraction and code portability. Then, make the isolation must be the hardware role. Anyway, the ISA has another role to play by allowing exchange about security between hardware and software. In this way, we can reach a compromise and have the benefits of both parts. Because the ISA is the base of our system, it must be defined before the hardware and the software. In our case, we can distinguish some constraints to respect. First, we want to be able to consider the whole isolation issue. Consider the issue part by part leads to countermeasure, stacking, and complexity. Moreover, only consider temporal sharing, like in many solutions, finally, does not completely resolve the whole isolation issue. Second, we want to be able to create custom security domains. Our ISA must give the needed tools to fit any software constraint depending the implemented application. Third, ideally, we want that our ISA can fit to multiple implementation, from simple microcontrollers to complex server, where the number of execution can completely vary. And finally, we want to preserve the ISA abstraction. This abstraction allows to implement them independently, so the hardware and the software, and preserve code portability. It has not to consider all the possible variation of implementation. For all these reasons, we have chosen to allow contextualization by associating a domain to each data and resource. Then, the hardware is able anywhere and anytime to know when sharing is possible or not. And we call, in our case, this new notion of context a DOM. To add DOM support, we have extended the RISC-V ISA with two main features. The first one is new register to indicate precisely in which DOM each hardware thread or core is. They are used to store information about the current and the next DOM. So each DOM has an identifier value and some associated capabilities, which indicates to the hardware the DOM needs. So for example, this need can be the possibility to perform operation like multiplication or division. We also had a new instruction called DOM switch, which indicates to the hardware when a DOM change occurs. Then when it is necessary, the software can indicate to the hardware this need, and the hardware becomes responsible to manage the different shared resources. And finally, a new security domain can be executed only if this different operation at the hardware level and hidden for the software are successful, because it indicates that the security can be ensured by the system. With DOMS, the hardware has now new information about the different security domains. Then it must ensure that these new constraints are respected at the hardware level by ensuring the isolation. So shared resource design must be adapted to not leak information between different domains. Due to the important number of different shared resources, we cannot consider them one by one. So we want a global strategy for any shared resource. Our goal is to modify shared resource design to not allow extra information sharing between DOMs. More precisely, a DOM must only be able to recover its own data and the static availability from a shared resource. By static availability, we mean the indication that a DOM has the possibility to use a resource. It is opposed to dynamic availability, which indicates precisely that a resource is currently in use. Dynamic availability leads to resource contention and exploitable information, as proven by several attacks. Finally, we can summarize our modifications in three complementary strategies: lock, split, and flush. The first strategy, lock, allows a DOM to allocate the resources that it needs during its creation until its deletion. No more dynamic sharing of resources leading to leakage between DOMs is possible. Two mechanisms are used for that: static allocation and tagging. Then during DOM creation, hardware allocates some resources and indicates with tags which DOM is the owner. After that, at any point in time and space, the hardware is able to know if sharing through a resource is possible or not. Here, for example, only requests coming from the DOM D0 can be acknowledged. The resource is not available for D1 and simply does not exist for it. The previous lock strategy allows to allocate a resource in an exclusive way. Another strategy called split allows to spread duplicated resources between different executed DOMs. So for example, cache lines can be divided, and then each DOM has access to only its own part of cache data. One way to implement this principle is to use spatial partitioning, which is a well-known mechanism in the literature. So finally, we can see that the whole system is split between the two DOMs. But there is some resource that they cannot be splitted or fully allocated, because they are needed by all the DOMs. So it is, for example, the case of memory buses or memory controllers. In this case, to prevent leakage due to contention, the solution is to split the availability of the resource. By using a mechanism like temporal partitioning, each DOM has access to a resource only during a time slot. Outside of its time slot, a DOM is not able to know if the resource is currently used or not, so it cannot deduce information usage about the other DOMs. Different implementations of temporal partitioning exist and have been successfully applied to execution units or cache controllers, for example. Split and lock only focus on resource allocation, but when the execution of a DOM is ended, its resources can be released. However, some information or data can be stored in register or memory even if the resource is no more allocated. Then they must be deleted to ensure that the future DOM using this resource will not recover them. The corresponding mechanism is called flush and is known as particularly efficient against temporal sharing. So different processes using the same resource at different points in time cannot use this resource to leak information. Finally, in a secure implementation which respects all the previous design principles, each resource has a defined lifecycle. A free resource can be allocated by a new DOM. After that, this DOM can freely use it and the other DOMs see this resource as unavailable. When the DOM is ended, the resource is flushed before being released and then it becomes free to a new allocation. In the simplest case where only one DOM is executed at any time, so there is no spatial sharing, this lifecycle can be simplified. Each resource can only be usable by the current DOM or flush to prepare the execution of a new DOM. Now we will see the impact of DOMs on both hardware and software sides. So on the software point of view, we simply consider that our code is always executed in a particular DOM. Then, when we want to isolate some application, we can indicate it to the hardware with the DOM switch instruction. In our example, the first part of the code is executed in a DOM. We then parameterize a new future DOM before performing a switch. And finally, the last part of our code is in a different DOM, and the hardware is responsible in background to ensure that to answer the isolation. So no more sharing is possible between the previous code and the new code. On the hardware side, each resource and data is owned by a particular DOM. The processor is able to know at any time if a domain can use it or not. In our example, we have two threads running in the same DOM in red. Sharing is allowed, so both threads have access to all the resources like all cache lines or execution units. Later, one of the threads performs a DOM switch. After preparing the different needed resources, we have two different DOMs executed at the same time, one in red and one in green here. Due to contextualization, the implementation is able to precisely know which sharing can be done or not at any level. Some resources are fully allocated, like the execution unit, and other ones, like cache, are splitted. Finally, this strategy has been implemented successfully in two different cores, so a simple one with only temporal sharing, and another one with simultaneous multithreading, and which correspond to the illustration here. An important phase during the design is the evaluation of our implementation. Particularly, it can be useful to know for each microarchitecture which kind of leakage exists or not. And in our case, we want to be able to compare our implementation with or without DOMs. So during our work, we have tried to think of a way to evaluate our implementation. This led us to the development of a security benchmark called TimeSecBench to quantitatively evaluate the information leakages in the microarchitecture. So our constraints were to show the lack of timing information leakage in the more implementation agnostic manner, so to allow evaluation and comparison. We want to consider the more common shared resources like cache memories or prediction tables, for example, to be able to export our benchmark to other implementation. And finally, we want to focus on vulnerability, not exploitability, because we want to show that a leakage exists, not if it can be used and how. For that, we have selected the common covert channel scenario where a Trojan encodes the value in a shared resource state and the spy tries to recover it. To illustrate this, we have the case of temporal sharing in cache memories. The Trojan encodes its value by storing a data in a particular set of the memory, and later the spy tries to detect it. Here we have 8 different sets, so 8 different possible locations for the data to finally encode a 3-bit value. In the unprotected case, so the left picture, we see that by measuring the timing access, the spy is able to recover the value in any set, so corresponding to black square. The L1D cache has some leakage between the Trojan and the spy. In the right side, in the protected case, we perform a dump switch between the Trojan execution and the spy execution. They have to be isolated. Then we see that no more timing variation depending the set accessed by the Trojan is detected by the spy. So no more leakage exists between them. So the different mechanism launched by the dump switch are efficient. Finally, we have implemented the same kind of benchmark for other shared resources like L1 instruction cache, branch history table or branch target buffer, which are shared temporally. But also, we have targeted L1 data cache and execution unit shared spatially between different threads. And in all these tested cases, we can see that our modifications are efficient and no more leakages are observable between the Trojan and the spy. Many more benchmarks can be developed to try different shared resources and ensure that they are not the root of leakages. And we are currently exploring this way. And we are also trying to export these benchmarks to other targets to compare the results and make TimeSecBench a more generic tool. So now to conclude about this presentation. We saw that shared resources are sources of vulnerability, particularly timing information leakages. And by modifying the ISA and introducing a new DOM notion, it is possible to allow security exchange between hardware and software while preserving the abstraction. It allows the software to indicate its constraints and the hardware can be adapted to respect them. Finally, we introduce a new security benchmark to evaluate our implementation, which, in addition to our shared resource design principle, can guide a hardware designer in his choice. So thanks for watching this presentation, and do not hesitate if you have any questions.